Sir Richard Shuttleworth.
Hi everybody, it's good to be here. Thanks Vince for inviting me. This is the second day. What I'll do is I'll start off just review a little bit about yesterday. So those of you who weren't here yesterday, I'll just summarise what we discussed. We talked yesterday a little bit about skill, and I'll just introduce that over the next few minutes. And I'll just wait for some of the coaches to sit down as well. They've just arrived. Yesterday we discussed, because I've been asked to talk about constraints approach, constraints coaching is part of coaching. It's not the only way to coach. England Institute of Sport have adopted the approach to their Olympic coaching, and their national sports organisations like British Hockey, GB Hockey, England Rugby, which I was in control of, and England Football have all adopted the constraints approach. I know Jai Chow's coming later this morning, and I was working with Jai a little bit in Singapore, in New Zealand, on non-linear pedagogy. Those concepts have been adopted over the world now. So I just really want to stress that we'll talk about that today. But what I'll do is I'll just do a brief summary for those of you who weren't here today. We talked about technique, and hopefully we will be able to see the brightness of this. But we looked yesterday at how technique is perfect, outcome is perfect, it's very ordered, very structured. And then the girls take their shots randomly, how they start to miss some of their shots, how that is actually, that's actually the skill. We talked yesterday about the girls are timing their shots when the other girls are not shooting, so it's actually a skill because it's externally timed. Technique is internally timed. It's timed when I want to do it. Okay. People shooting next door right now, when they go into competition, you've got time. You've got a timer. You're nervous. You've got to get a perfect shot away at some stage. So you vary this. Vary time constraints. Have a competitor with somebody so they're always monitoring something whilst they're doing their techniques. Okay. So we're trying to focus more on skill. Okay, so that was a general example we showed yesterday. Remember we talked about the early start position? So now they practice their shots in very simple situations, but very varying starting positions. If you had some parents watching this, they'd go, where's the coaching? It's a bit messy, they can do this in the backyard, why would you come into coaching to do this? Well, way it's being coached, and they'll practice more like this now. If you think of this as technique, when you do drills or repetition, what you're doing is deepening the valley. So the behaviour is nice and comfortable down here, it's quite stable. We talked yesterday about stability and instability. Achieve stability, accuracy. But to do that, the system will be moving. Heart rate, nervousness, your body will be pumping blood around the body, it's unstable. The system is unstable. But you're trying to create stability, it's two things happening together. It's not one thing, stability. So to get movement, you're trying to groove a behavior or a technique. Okay? That's a well-grooved, ingrained technique. The lower it goes down. What we're trying to do to get skill though is make it shallow and make it wider. And that looks different for different sports. So for shooting, it's going to be different to basketball. So this well here for shooting will probably be a little deeper. Still wide, but it won't be very, very deep, very wide. The athletes who drill and then grain their techniques down here, so it's very deep. When they're under pressure, they find it very difficult to adapt. Find it very difficult mentally,
and physically to be able to change their behaviour to adapt for any sort of issues and problems. So behaviour, when kids are young, coming up to about 17 or 18, we need to place this sort of here and here. So they're doing three or four different types of shooting technique. Because when they specialise into this one, they can adapt. But they don't start in here and stay in here. You start by moving around. And then later on, it becomes deeper and deeper. And the research shows that. And in my experience, I've seen it in many athletes as well.
Just going to put this in.
Okay, so when you see an athlete in here, and you see the technique being repeated too many times, it depends what the sport is, but what you want to try and do is destabilize it, and you use constraints for the behavior to fit out into this more functional behavior, okay? It's very hard sometimes for athletes to flip into here if they spend too much time in here. So multi-sports, we talked about this morning, multi-sports, transfer from maybe two or three disciplines, having a primary main sport, and then having a donor sport, a second sport. And that second sport helps you perform better than your first sport. And that's critical, especially when you start to specialize professionally at 16, 17, 18 upwards, should have at least one extra sport. So for team sports, parkour is, who's heard of parkour? Anybody? Yeah, parkour is you know, where the kids run around and off buildings and jump off walls and do rolls and they climb things. Any biomechanist here will be using passive and reactive force. Okay? And when kids are doing these things, they can't necessarily plan what they will do. They see an object and they have to use it to push off. Go to another object, and they use their body to make decisions and act. So that's a donor sport for most of those sports, particularly Spanish football, or English football, they use parkour. I think it will benefit, it's like gymnastics, bringing gymnastics back for general movement, fundamental movement across sports. In England, we're tending to lose sports like gymnastics and judo at schools, and kids can't move as well. And then they specialise into sports very, very early, and they lack this experience of being able to move and control a center of mass. Yet they're trying to do a perfect tennis shot, and they can't even get a stable base of support. So moving children and youth into these areas here is critical for a longer period of time.
Any questions so far? Just put a hand up and yell out. I was saying yesterday, if I was doing this chat in England, after 20 minutes, I have 100 questions by 20 minutes. So it's up to you. If you don't ask any questions, you don't work, alright? And I won't make you ask any either.
Okay, so we talked yesterday about the learning pattern. When someone learns, the role of the coach is to put pressure on the skill of the athlete. Make it tough for them, make it hard, okay? Make it just at the right level for what they can achieve, and they start to go into the learning pattern. Okay, and the goal is for the athlete is to find their way out, find a new solution. Very much depends on the sport, of course, but to get them out of the learning pattern, it's great confidence by the athlete to know they can adapt and find a solution to get out. This is good for team sports and individual sports, putting an athlete in the learning pattern. In the learning pit, your relationship as a coach with your athletes must be one of belief. You must trust your athletes to find a way. And they will look at you and think, are you going to help me? Yeah, I'm here for you, I'm here for you, keep trying. And you need to find the balance of giving information and solutions and letting them find a way out. And some of the best coaches I've worked with have been PE teachers. They understand learning. They understand what it takes to find a solution. Because some of those coaches have played sport but they've never reached the top quickly. They've taken quite a while to get to the top. Why? Because those coaches have to find a solution themselves. if you're very gifted, very talented, and you go to the top very quickly, you generally don't have to search too much for many solutions. And they don't end up being that great coaches either. So the coaches who struggle to get up there never necessarily made the top. They can understand what the performer's going through, and they can help them find different ways and different solutions. So whatever coach you are, it doesn't matter if you're on to the top or you have them, understand the learner and how they learn. This might work now.
You don't really instill anything into a child. You encourage the development of it. But I would do all kinds of things to mess him up. Just as he's beginning to swing, I'd drop my whole bag of clubs. And he would stop. He would look at me and grit his teeth. Stripe it and turn around and look at me. And never say a word, but that look said, I'll take that. It's a tiger, and I promise you that you'll never meet another person as mentally tough as you in your entire life. And he hasn't.
Did you hear that? Right at the very beginning, what did he say? What did the father say? What would he do? Very beginning of the clip.
You don't really instill anything into a child. You encourage the development of it.
So what does that mean? I'll give you a minute. Talk to me. If you don't, I'll stop the lecture and I'll leave. Alright? Serious. I've done it before. So you're either going to feed back to me or I'll leave. Figure it out. What did he just say? Alright? You guys talk to each other in pairs if you like, and you guys talk to each other in pairs. What did he just say? Alright? And then you come back to me. Ready? I'll give you 30 seconds.
You don't really instill anything into a child. You encourage the development of it. I would do all kinds of things to mess him up. Just as he's beginning to swing, I'd drop my whole bag of clubs. And he would stop. He would look at me and grit his teeth. And then he would stripe it and turn around and look at me. And never say a word, but that look said, I'll take that.
So have a quick rise that. Coaching is about making athletes respond. That's what it is. So you mess up your athletes. It's a paradox, it's ironic that you're there to support, but you're there to mess them up. And just as they're ready to do something, you drop your bag of clubs, you look around. So in essence, you don't do distraction training with a psychologist. You distract them all the time. And they're constantly trying to perform. And as because of that become resilient, they develop a very robust technique, which is basically a skill. A robust technique is a skill. You're not doing technique training. Technique's very easy. It's a very simple coordination pattern, but then you put that under pressures, all sorts of pressure, and it can be fun for the students. Really, really good fun, all right? And the more they're used to that, they'll come to a place like this and they'll have no problems. Doesn't matter what coach they have. And they can feel their movements, they can change their technique, and they're the athletes that we're looking for, particularly in Australia and in England as well, moving forward. But you have to have an education system and a philosophy that suits that as well. Anything from you, Gosh?
You go to Spain and watch them coach Barcelona. They don't say anything. They've got the most skillful players around. And I totally agree with what Emma was saying. And I work with technical sports also. It's about design, it's how you design your sessions. The more you have to intervene, when you have to have interventions, it, to me, is a measure of you as a coach. If you don't have to intervene too many times, but you intervene at the right time, it's all about when you intervene. So observation as a coach is critical. Nowadays, in our coach education system, we don't have anything to do with observation. What are you observing? What cues are you observing in your training session? What behaviours are you looking for? What learning are you looking for? What adaptation are we looking for? You go to good coaches, the Spanish football coaches, they're looking for cues and behaviours, and they'll come in and say a couple of things and step back out. The design of the session is putting pressure on the action and the skill. And the athlete's role in the practice session is to adapt. If they fail, it's failing to adapt in the session. And the athlete has the responsibility not to fail, because they're accountable for their performance in training. So we're not responsible for it. We will pressure, we will support you to make a good decision, and we will design a session that puts you under a bit of pressure. So that will be the design of a coach. You have to be the world's best designers of training and practice. And those skills are not necessarily taught in coach education, but some of you here will have those skills. And my job really is to work with coaches. I work with GB hockey, England rugby, football, boxing, some individual sports at EIS. Some of the coaches are very good designers. They tend to come sometimes from Eastern Europe. They have degrees. They understand learning, they understand behavior, whereas other coaches come through the system are talking a lot of feedback, a lot of instruction, and their interventions are not based on the learner, the timing of what they're trying to do. So it's forced, it's like forcing science onto practice. Science supports practice. Data, GPS, supports practice. It doesn't direct it, it supports it. So as a good coach, you have to observe and observe the interaction of the training, design the session and review it. So that's something, that's the key message today. I think this afternoon, Vince will probably talk a bit more about that, because I think they're the issues, the real issues of coaching that we're going to be confronted with in the future. So yeah, really good up the back. I think you were involved in a team sport, football. I think sometimes for individual technical sports, they will argue that we need more volume in repetition and drilling a technique. But we would argue against that as well, because we know in the research, you do need variability in your practice design. So athletes become adaptable in their techniques, they become skillful. Okay, anybody on this side want to say anything based on that so far?
Question.
Yep.
At what time do you let the athlete know that you are trying this on them?
Yeah, so at what time do you let the athlete know you're trying this? You remember the clip yesterday I showed of a backyard games with the two brothers? You might have seen it. They're already doing it, but they don't know. If you go to New Zealand, in some countries, and you talk to the coaches about implicit learning, they know what it is and they're doing it. Who's heard of implicit learning? Hand up or hand down? Implicit learning. Alright, I know some people know and they're not putting their hand up, but every one of you here should be going, I do it. 90% of my coaching is implicit. If you say no, what's that mean? Yeah, I give instructions, I give feedback. That basically means you're an explicit coach. Learning, how do you learn to walk? Implicitly. Most of your ontological skills are implicit. Yet when they come to a professional coach, the world becomes explicit. The world becomes about instruction, feedback. It's forced intervention. It's not natural. And suddenly they start to think, oh, I have to listen. My job now is to listen, copy, mimic, repeat, make a decision that the coach wants me to make so I get it. It becomes It's not all like that. I'm not saying it's like that here. I'm saying you've got to watch out because that's the way it's heading very quickly. To answer your question, it's there from the beginning and we take that away. We get rid of any sort of creativity and variability and say, right now, you're in our system. The role of the coach suddenly goes from the learner, which you coach yourself, when you're looking and you're at school, you try things, you practice, and then suddenly you come into a professional coach, and that role, responsibility is taken away from you, and then we take away the variability of practice. So suddenly, when we talk about constraints coaching, we have to have an intervention and say, right, how do we now deliver this? I don't want an intervention, really, to be honest, to deliver such a program. I would rather the schools, the education systems, the government understand the system that we're generating, and we have schools that have multi-sports. We have an invasion-based camp, so a kid can't just play football because you have to play basketball. You also have to play hockey because you also have to play water polo because they're the same principles. Going forward, penetration, support width, support depth, continuity, pressure. Individual sports, you've got the same principles of movement, rotation, linear movements, acceleration, power. They're the same principles. The more you specialize early on, the more you limit athletes from transferring those skills. So when they specialize after 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, they can't transfer from another sport into their primary sport. So variability starts when they're young. What we do is we take it away and then we have to bring it back in. I know I'm being very long with a really good question and I'm being long with the answer. What I would say is some athletes are not ready for bringing in variability training sometimes. They feel too unstable. It's too uncertain. Yesterday we did a talk in the afternoon. Was anybody here in the afternoon yesterday? Just put your hand up. And we had a slide about safety uncertainty. Teach sevens though, in sevens coaching. Well, compare that with 15s rugby. With 15s rugby, it's more certain. You've got more players, you've got a role and responsibility. Sevens, you're not quite sure where the space is going to be. You have to be a bit more heads up. Why is it in Australia, when you take sevens rugby players and put them into the 15s games, they're the first ones to score tries? Why are they the first players in Australia? When the seventh season's finished, those players go back to play 15s. They're the ones who are always making the breaks. They're the ones who are scoring the tries. And then after about a month or 2 months, they stop scoring the tries. And then it goes back to normal, like 15s players. Why is that the case? Simple. In sevens, they're taught to look for space, keep their head up. They don't structure the play as much. They have a bit of a formation on the left and the right, but apart from that, so when they go to 15s, they're looking up for opportunities. Where's the opportunity? And they take initiative, got more responsibility. When they go to 15s, there's so many people here. I'll just do my job, just do my role. They come here in places like this. Same thing, shit, put my head down, just do what I need to do. This should be an institute for creativity. This should be an institute for learning. It should be an institute for producing the next world's best athlete that no one's seen before. And that comes from implementing variability and creativity into your sessions. Tiger Woods wasn't coached. He had people who were annoying him, harassing him, making it difficult for him. And he found a way. So it's that balance between support, supporting him, giving him technical advice, but then pressuring him back into a skill. So yesterday I showed that slide. Do you remember the slide with all the circles going around? That's my model. It's not to say that it's your model. It's how I perceive we should coach. So you guys have your own framework. I'll show that again for other people. But it's never too early, it's never too late. I could have answered it with that, couldn't I? Then just carry on. It's never too early, it's never too late. It depends on the needs of your athlete. So everyone's got different athletes. And you must perceive what their needs are. We may have all seen this. So Shuttleworth, when we traditionally learn things in today's society with professional coaching, we come from the left to the right. So repetitions, to repeat practice. We do a series of exercises, and suddenly we get more variability in the practice. Who's heard of contextual interference? Anybody heard of contextual interference? If I come back next year, then I want everyone's hand that night. Everybody's hand should be, yeah, I use contextual interference training. Differential learning. Hands up if you've heard of differential learning, shoulder. Yeah, alright. You should all be doing differential learning. This is where optimal learning takes place. That's your best learning in there. As soon as you do this, and you can do it two or three times. Don't do it again. Put them straight into here. Straight in there. This is how kids learn. This is how kids learn. Walking, free movement. Move space, explore space around you. Do dance, do gymnastics, do movement, do judo. Do skateboarding, do parkour, do football. Explore your movements. And then they start to go in this zone here. If you had an institute or an academy that went from this way, I would love to see it. It will be the future. Because that will be the response to what's going on around the world right now, which goes from this direction. Okay? So that was by Shuttleworth to show where optimal learning takes place. Differential learning means you may do a golf shot, and the second golf shot is going to be different. You have to stand further away. The third one, you can stand pretty close. The fourth one, you do it with a straight right arm. Every shot will have to be different, but you're still trying to get the ball to the same place. So the outcome changes, but the process to adapt itself. Kids do this all the time in the backyard. They don't know it. They're doing it all the time. They're doing differential learning. But we never do it in full coaching to a degree. We showed this yesterday. Blocked practice and variable practice. Blocked practice is outperforming in the practice session. That's the practice session. Alright? Variable practice is underneath. So block practice is outperforming the whole time. And so coaches start to think, yeah, they're learning. This looks really good. They're performing really well. And then when you come back and you do a learning test, you get this information. So blocked practice, all the children who've been repeating this again and again, and then you do a retention test, which is learning, and their performance drops, and the variable practice group goes up. So this is multi-sport. Or this could be kids who are practicing a badminton shot, and they do the shot, and then they go over here and they pick a football, or they do another badminton shot, which is completely different. They come back, and they produce the same skill A badminton shot. Variable practice, don't see a lot of it in professional coaching right now. We use it in Australian Institute of Sport with individual sports like archery, and shooting we did it with. Athletics, we did it with shot put, discus, javelin. We did it with a range of sports where we introduced more variable practice. You get significant gains, but you have to do it for a period of time because performance will go down, and then performance goes back up and it goes a lot higher. Okay, if you do block practice, performance goes like this sometimes and it plateaus. If you want these sort of gains, you have to try different things, and that's where variable practice is really good. So, we can always chat this afternoon if you want to talk about that a bit more. Okay. That was from yesterday. if you didn't see this yesterday, you're like, whoa, what? There's a lot of stuff on there. But just remember, yesterday we talked about when you coach an athlete, really what you're doing is this. You're coaching their intention. Their intention to want to do something. And that needs to be coupled with their attention. What are they going to focus on? Are they focusing on their movement? Are they focusing on having an effect on an opponent? Or on the target? So attention drives intention, drives attention. Make sure you design your session around the skill level, the capabilities of your athlete has to match the opportunities that you've designed in your training session. So you design a training session for the opportunities that must match the skill of your athletes. And that drives attention, attention, okay? That's the center of it. And then on the outside is all the things that you can vary in your session. You can design a session which has one skill, or the athlete has to decide between several skills, inter-skill. Vary the picture every time. In archery, always remember the day that we had the target 70 meters away. We got Olympic archers, and they went up, and we took away the ropes. They have a rope down the side. And we took away the ropes, and we put the target in the middle of the football pitch. And they come down to training the next day, and they're like, how come we're training on the football pitch? And we said, okay, we've got a competition today, and we're going to test you. And part of this will be your selection for India at the Commonwealth Games. And they go, yeah, okay, but why did you put the target 80 metres away? It was 70 metres. Why do they think it's 80 metres? Because you put it in the middle of the football pitch. Because they're structured. They come down to training, they expect it to be 70. The line ropes give them information to say 70, but when you take those things away, they're like, how far is that? Because they've never been pressured, they've never been tested. You go to Olympic Games, you're going to have different things around you. It'll still be 70 metres. And all of that information is distracting. It's like Tiger Woods' father dropping a golf club. Hey, there's a bush over there. Oh, there's a bit of wind over there. Still 70 metres. Crikey, are you sure? So we changed things up completely. And we got big results from some young athletes who love that sort of training. And they find it interesting and enjoyable as well. Okay, so that was one of the frameworks what I showed you yesterday. This is just an England rugby team. Okay, this is an example of using constraints. This is me down here, and I'm pulling in with a rubber band. Okay, for those of you who were here yesterday, what he's going to try and do is he's running with the ball, and that's say like a defender in front. Okay, he's trying to pass the ball this way. What happens in English rugby is when you pass the ball to the left, the body moves to the left. So you can see the hurdle there. He's meant to go over the top, and he's kind of around it. He's not aware. So he will ask the question, where did you go? And he said, yeah, I went over the top. He didn't, mate. He didn't. And he doesn't know. How many of your athletes are aware of what they do in training? Probably, sometimes not. So how do you expect an athlete to adapt their technique when they think they're performing a certain way? How many of your athletes have got a good sense of feel? Who has really good feel? What sport? What activity do you think has good feel? Good kinesthetic awareness? What activity?
Wrestling.
Yeah. You're a wrestler.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Dance. Dancers. Australian swimming team has instructors. They're dancers. If you want to play around with any of your technique, you get a dancing instructor in there. They talk to you differently. And they'll ask you, try this, how does it feel? Did your speed increase? Yeah, did it. When I do this, that increases. They create problem solvers. They create this mindset in a swimmer to think about what the effect is of what they're doing. Okay? So you've got to generate feel in your athletes, otherwise you can't coach them. Because they're just going to copy what you say. My elbow, yeah, my elbow. They won't realize, is that good or is that bad? How does that feel? In archery, actually, we had to take away things. So if you're shooting at the target and you try a different technique, and the arrow goes into two, what's the athlete going to think? That technique's rubbish. It doesn't work. What happens if you turn the lights off and I shoot the arrow and I can't see where it goes and I try a new technique? What am I going to think? Can't see the arrow. That felt a bit funny. I'll try that. Try it again. You don't get the feedback. You think more about the technique. Give the feedback, now that's a rubbish shot too. I won't try that technique. You go back to what you normally do. So you have to play around with that information for athletes to explore their movements. Okay? Skill acquisition, good skill acquisition. So that's what I worked with the coaches to do that sort of stuff. We did it in the archery. Playing Connect Four, he's playing Connect Four. Brilliant game to do with the archery. They just try and get four colours with four arrows. Alright, I get three blue and then my partner scores a blue, so I have to go for a different colour. You've got variability in the target. It's not the same target every time, it's always changing. Okay, so variability in practice. We discussed that yesterday. Okay, today, in England, there's a big push at the Institute of Sport to push coaches into this middle bit here. So on the left is science. Empirical science, best practice, the principles of good coaching. On the right-hand side is your coaching. It's called experiential learning, your experience. So we tend as coaches to live in here. As scientists, we live in the left here. What we have to do as coaches is move ourselves out of here and live in this space in the middle. I started my career as a coach, and I was in here. And when I stopped finishing, I started to coach a team, and I thought, what makes a really skilled athlete? And you have to jump into here and start looking at some of the research. And then you start to realize that, wow, you have to live in this space here. So once you look at the research, you look at practice, why are my sessions good, not good? And then you learn, and then that transfers into the science. You can have a chat with an academic and say, what about variability, differential learning? Why is it good, why is it not good? So both inform each other. And I think this is where we're moving now as coaches. The best coaches will sit in this area here, very curious.
To change. Member coach in England, 2009 Six Nations, and I told a player where to stand in training. And I told him again the day after. Because I told him, I didn't necessarily confirm that he knew where to stand when he was on his own. I didn't confirm the learning. So we went out and played against Ireland at Twickenham. He was in the wrong position. And I said to Martin Johnson, I said, well, I told him where to stand, and Martin goes, yeah, no, I was stood next to you when you told him. But we were missing a trick. You know, it's not what I know, where he should stand. He needs to know where he needs to stand. So I needed to confirm that learning, and I never did. And from that day, I changed the way I coached. I signed for Wigan in 1983, and you have coaches, but you look back at where you were coached back then in the 80s and 90s, and it was very much a tell environment where you got told what to do, and if you didn't do what you got told, you probably didn't get selected. Coaches evolve so much now, it's very much player-led environments these days, player empowerment. You give the players the tools to perform at the weekend, but ultimately they decide which tool to use, and you know, they have a lot of say in how the game should be played and how you should be training. So certainly at Bath Rugby, it's a very much a player-led environment, and I think that's the difference. We coaches at Bath never tell. We ask questions. We want to know what the players know.
Okay, so that is an example of the transition coaching right now at the professional Olympic level. I work with three coaches around the world. Wayne Smith, back in the day, who changed the culture of New Zealand rugby back in 2003. But those coaches get sacked normally in the first couple of years because the system is not ready for you. You challenge the system. Why should I tell the players? Well, because we need a win. If you don't get a win, you're not going to be a coach next year. So that stifles future creativity because we need instant performance success right now. So you're not ready for the system. You're a good coach, but you're not ready for the system, and that needs to be broken. And that's part of today of what we're talking about, is how do you function inside a system like this. So he's a coach that learned. He learned to sort of ask questions, and he found it very, very difficult. But you've got to learn to ask the right questions, and that's the thing. This doesn't come through very well, but this is the challenges of coaches that I looked at in England for the last 4 years. What are the main challenges? The performance environment, to win at all costs at the expense of development. That was the number one. I asked all the coaches to feedback to me what the biggest pressures were. Number one, performance environment. We need to win at the cost of learning and development. How often is that happening here? Tradition and culture. To resist change. Changing our ways. Resist changing our ways. We've got coaches here that probably think, what can I do differently? If you've got that mindset, that's good. If you haven't, and you keep protecting what you're doing, that you're not sharing information, I don't think you're going to go a hell of a long way. There won't be too much longevity. You have to challenge yourself. How many people here have what I call a thinking friend? Who have you got who challenges you when you coach? Have you got somebody you can call up on the phone and say, look, what should I be doing here? I've tried this out. If anyone comes to your session and watched you, then you probably do this a bit with some of the coaches that you work. But you'll be surprised at how many coaches don't have support. I mean, you'll go away and you'll think, shit, there's a couple of good things today that I heard from Shuttleworth. You'll go away, you'll do it. You don't have anyone to help you or look at you and see the athletes, how they respond. Get somebody. That's what community of coaching practice is. Do it at the elite level. So we've got elite coaches now who are helping each other use some of these methods. I'm talking a world-class standard. We'll play some of the Danny Carey clips for hockey in a minute. I just want to show you, who's heard of the All Blacks, New Zealand? Yeah. Anybody? I know it's a team sport, but let's look what happened. 2003-5, they won nothing. They lost the World Cup. In South Africa, after the World Cup, they got drunk. The South Africans were picking the players out of the bushes the next day after the World Cup. They were completely drunk. They just lost their whole respect of the game. They lost their philosophy and their identity in around 2005-7. They came out with a strategy plan. This is their philosophy back then. We want to lead the way the game is being played and coached. New Zealand has a proud history in shaping the way rugby is played. The tradition has been built on our ability to adapt quicker than any other country to the changing rules and laws of our game. We will enjoy the game. That's their number one, enjoyment of the game. How many of you coaches every day can see your athletes enjoy what you do? I've been looking at the highest performing athletes in the Australian shoot sport, the sailors, and the Victor Kovalenko. He looks like a tough bloke, but I can guarantee you, every one of his athletes enjoys everything that they do. Because he challenges them to be better, and they enjoy getting better, they enjoy getting challenged. Coaching at player innovation. They want to be the best in the world at player innovation coaching. Positive approach to change. So how much are we changing every day? How much is our athlete willing to change? What they did yesterday was yesterday. What they're doing today has to be better than yesterday. If they're doing the same thing, you've got to challenge them. Sharing of information and using technology. New Zealand create the right environment to encourage information sharing and problem solving. When comparing ourselves to the rest of the world, our current practice of sharing information is our point of difference. Why is New Zealand rugby good? Who's heard of their competition? They've got Super 16, they've got four or five teams in New Zealand. They have to share information. How many of you share information with your competitors? How many athletes actually go to the other athlete? This is what I'm going to do in training against you in the match. This is what we're doing. In New Zealand, they do it every day. Each team knows what each other's doing. What's that going to do? Make it bloody difficult to win the game. The coach knows that. So they have to find marginal gains, millimeters. So they have to change. If they don't change, they die. Who benefits from this? New Zealand All Blacks. They got five teams who are willing to change, willing to adapt to win. So they have to even out the competition. Got to even it out. We don't get that in the Six Nations or other competitions in Europe. It looks good winning, but it doesn't do us any good. So Eddie Jones recently, who I work with, he absolutely killed all our players before the Six Nations. They were knackered. They were knackered before the first game, and they lost three or four of the games. You have to do it if you're going to learn. What can you do when you're absolutely fatigued? What happens to your technique? What happens to your decision making? The players have never been there before. The feedback after the Six Nations was, we've never been there before. That was really uncomfortable. That was so good. The feedback was, we need to be here. This is where we need to be right now. So that's a shared information. And the last one here is, our coaches were open to change and actively leveraged off the thinking of our players. So who leads the session? Yeah, it is the All Blacks coaches. But it's not really. When you go and watch one of the sessions, who's leading it? Richie McCaw, Kieran Reid. In your coaching sessions, and I said this yesterday, you have to empower your players, your athletes, to lead the session. And you hold them accountable. And as soon as they step over the unacceptable mark, you're onto them. Onto them. But apart from that, they're free. So it's getting that balance. They've got to have responsibility. And what you do is you leverage, which means you use them to advance the training session. They need to improve that training session. It's not you, the coach. They improve it. So together you design the best practice for next time. And some coaches call it optional. You can decide to design your own session once a week or something. Do it all the time. If you can get your athletes to the point where, coach, why don't we change this? I need to work more on this. I want to do this. And you question them. You actually train them how to design. Train them how to design. We're shifting quickly in the UK across to the athletic skills model, which shifts from multi-sport, where we've got good movers. And then we have a donor sport when they get to sort of 13, 14, and then technically adaptive training, sports adaptation training, and then sports specific. Okay, this is a continual model from Ajax, isn't it? Yeah, it's Ajax. I know Vincent is looking at this as well, but we're using that in our sporting systems as well now in the UK. So this is an idea of having skill and movement in the early stages of learning. This is a great GB hockey team doing their donor sport. So hockey, their donor sport would be a version of, yeah. It's obviously not doing it really well, handball. They're gonna play at least 2-3 hours each week of handball. So this is their introduction into handball, and then it's going to get more and more serious. They're going to go to handball courts and play the proper sport. But now they're introducing at least half an hour in every training session of handball. Now if you're a coach, obviously there's a reason why you're doing this. You have to use deception to create space. You have to use movements to create opportunities for yourself. You have to lose your partner. You'll notice there's always man on marking. You have to lose your partner to try and find a space. Same as hockey. There will be transfer. We talked about the constraints model. Jai Chow's coming later today. He's been part of this as well. So we use this in many different sports now in the UK. England football and their youth. So in England football, they have a constraints-based coaching principle. So they have four pillars to their program. Constraints-based coaching. What they have here is called the player is the syllabus. So they've moved away from curriculums now. They've moved to individual-based syllabuses. Okay? And this is called the principles of play. So every sport will be based around certain principles. So this is the principles of football. You'll have principles of archery, principles of shooting, there'll be certain principles which will help you make your decisions. And then play and practice. How many drills versus how many games, like variability. So you get that balance right for a particular sport. So that's an example of England football and how the power of constraints-based coaching is moving the game forward. And it's not very good quality on this, but I did this because I went over to France and I started to look at why the kids were such good movers. In France, they're unbelievable. When they play team sports, the kids are amazing. They're much better than the, what we call in England, the Anglo-Saxons. Like, you know, the Romans, the Vikings, everyone came over. And then they built governments in England, castles, you know, the king and queen. It's very top-down, they have laws. It's very structured. People look down, you pay your taxes. Yes, yes, okay. So it's a very hierarchical society, right? Sport has come from the back of that. The role of the coach is I'm your boss, you do as you say. If you go to, let's just say, New Zealand or Australia, there are certain sports there where, particularly in the freestyle sports, canoe swim, skateboarding, some of the ski sports, that coach, piss off with me, you're not telling me what to do, I'm doing this. They rule the training session. Coach is like, well, they're nervous. The coach is nervous to say anything because they could get kicked out by their athlete. I want you to try that this year. Try coaching a skateboarder. Go to a surfer and try and coach a surfer because you will learn as a coach how to manage. Challenge yourself. Find where the local freestyler is. The problem is those athletes want to win a gold medal sometimes. To win a gold medal, you have to have a bit of structure. You have to tick some boxes. Canoe slalom, as you're going down white water, they can do whatever they like in freestyle. But to win a gold medal, you can't hit the gates. You've got to go through certain gates. You have to do certain things. They don't like to be told. Those athletes don't want to be coached. They coach themselves. So suddenly they have to adapt to the Olympic program. And that's where a lot of my work was involved in how do we do that? How do we embrace their creativity and their decision making to help them win a gold medal? This program here is quite interesting because those athletes have spent more time at the bottom. This is called movement, free movement. It's funny because in Australia, you don't have many mountains. There's not a lot of white water for canoe sliding. So what happens is you've got two types of athletes in canoe slalom. One that's been developed on flat water in Melbourne, and they are the like factory athletes, they're factory produced. And then you've got guys coming from what we call the Sydney Blue Mountains, white water rapids up in the high mountains. And these kids are pretty wild. They're like, you know, hippies, long hair, and they've probably done a bit of drugs. They've got, you know, necklaces, tattoos, they jump in the canoes, and they're just down in the water like anything. And they're doing all these tricks and stuff like that. And you suddenly got all these canoeists in a program together. And then you've got someone from Melbourne who's gone to school, they do everything you say, they sit there, they quiet, they wait for the coach to speak. And they get to the training session, four freestylers are already halfway down the course. Can we hear you? Hey, capsizing, have a fuck. So the Melbourne athletes start from the top. That's how they've started. They understand the sport because of its structure. And then they develop techniques and shapes based off that structure. And then they move into this free movement space, but they're not very comfortable down the bottom. Whereas you look at a kid from Singapore who's maybe, I don't know, come from the country. Do you have any country residents in this group? You must have some arable farmers. Are there any farmers who've got kids who play sport? Do you have any farmers? You watch those kids that have grown up outside. You know, they're not playing iPads or PlayStation, they're actually outside, dodging cars, playing games. And those kids live down here. And when you put them into a little bit of shape, technique, and then you put them into a bit of a structure, they don't like going up here, so they shoot back down the bottom. Certain sports, that's brilliant. Rugby. All Blacks love space. They love space and time. Once you start putting them up to the top here, they don't like it, they want to come back down here. Which traditionally, learning comes this way. You go to school, you learn your content, your subjects, and then you take it into life and learn how to use it. Whereas learning should really be, should come up this way. Come up this way. So, as a coach, it's trying to have a pathway where we have lots of general movement, and then we start to work on things like shape, how to, formations and systems, and then we move up to the actual structure, which is to win, you need to probably do a few plays, patterns and sequences. Okay, this is team sports and individual sports. So when I went to France, they hated up here. Who's been to France? Revolutions, executions, they eat snails, frogs' legs, they do things differently. You beat them at the war, they don't like fighting, sure. But they're pretty chaotic people, they're pretty random, they can't follow a plan. So when you go to a World Cup, you need a plan. You need a plan for the tournament, but you need an adaptive plan. If you follow a plan like the English do, very rarely do you win a World Cup. What happens in a tournament? It changes. Teams change, they learn. So the lesson that we picked up is probably from New Zealand. You go prepared, but be unprepared. Your first game, you just play your first game. After that, you change, and then you change again, and then you change again. And through the tournament, you get better, 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 better. England, Australia want to go there and win the tournament in game one. And when things don't work out, game two, shit, what's going on? Game three gets worse and worse. And because you're over-planning. You've pre-planned. You live in that certainty space on the left-hand side. You've done everything you can. You know it's going to work. The best athletes go there and they're expecting the unexpected. They feel comfortable, uncomfortable. You've put them in the certainty, safety, uncertainty space. That is the cue for moving forward as a coach now. So how do we design and live in that space with our athletes? How do we cause and manage chaos for them?
That's enough detail.
Okay, so we've got eight people in a circle. What I'd like you to do, and I've forgotten how to pose, so I'm going to adapt on the run. Hold the rope with your left hand. What I'd like you to do is reach across to the person opposite you, just you. And you grab that with that hand right there. Yeah, so it's left hand. Always hold every rope with left hand. Don't grab this rope now. You have to grab someone else's rope. Or anybody, yeah? That's it, grab his rope. So you reach across. That's right, you grab someone else's rope.
Anyone?
Yeah, you've got to grab someone else's rope. Okay, left hand to the person opposite and grab anyone else's rope. Who did you pass that to? Do the left hand one first, that's it. Whoa, okay. Right, can I have a coach? You're a coach, aren't you? Come on. Thanks for nominating yourself. Has anybody got a stopwatch? Anyone got a stopwatch? Okay. You have to untangle this mess. Technically, you give instructions. You can't move or do anything. You're holding the same rope for the same person. So start again. It's got to be a different person. Okay, what I'd like you to do now is unravel the mess. Okay, you can tell them how to move or where to do, where to go. You've got to listen to the coach, okay? Because I'm doing selection in 3 weeks. We've got a court competition.
All right, you've got to do as you tell. Everyone's got a role and responsibility. We're going to measure this coach on how quickly she can unravel the mess in training. Okay, are we ready on the stopwatch? Ready, go. Coach, I'm going to sack you if you say, I think. I've employed you because you need to know what you're doing, okay? So you've got to tell her. Come on, be precise. I'm only mucking around, by the way. She's a really nice coach, but she said, I think. Not many coaches say, I think. Who's running the clock? What are we up to? What's the time? Pressure on the coach.
35 seconds. 35,
come on, let's get it.
40 seconds. 45.
You're nearly up to a minute, coach. I've got another coach who can do this in 40 seconds. Why should I be investing in you?
Everyone's watching.
1 minute.
I think the parents are not very happy with you. Time.
1 minute 15. 1 minute 15.
Well done. Well done. That's brilliant. Really well done. So come back together and do the same thing with the ropes. Opposite. Can't hold the same rope from the person opposite. Okay. All right. This time, the coach will be. Are you ready? Who's going to be the coach, do you reckon, this time? These guys. All right, guys? You can't say anything. Oh, you can. Should I let you speak? Why not? Yeah, why not? Guys, you've got to beat 1 minute 45. You ready? Go! Go! So they did it in half the time. So see if they can do it. They just need to hold the opposite ropes, that's all. Is everyone different?
Yes.
Okay, as quickly as you can. Ready, go! Well done, guys. Okay, I'm going to leave it here, actually. Thanks very much, guys. Just give the ropes in the middle. Give them all a hand, people. Okay, what do we get from that? What happened with the first group of coaches? What was the difference between the second group when the athletes coached themselves? Why was it quicker? Just come in, everybody, just come in close, come in close. Why was it quicker? Yeah. Okay, let's ask the people in the room. So, when you're a coach, do we get feedback from the players? No, we don't, or athletes. We should actually ask them questions. So what actually did you think between the first group and the second group, the coach and the non-coach group? So the people onto the ropes, what were your reflections on that? What did you think?
The first...
Does this even work?
At the very basic, it's a numbers game really. It was one coach, one brain, and then when there were 8 of us, it was 8 brains.
So how did you feel when there was a coach telling you what to do?
Not very interested.
Not interested? Yeah. What else?
Well, I mean, we're waiting for instructions, so we're waiting for...
You have to wait, don't you? So before you waited, did you see any other opportunities?
Yes.
Yeah, of course. Where are you looking?
The people beside you.
You're looking at the people next to you. You're trying to solve problems, but who's holding you back? Coach, it happens all the time. Every sport I go into, there are opportunities which are going to be missed, left, right, and centre. Imagine if we gave that responsibility to the athlete to say, look, there are certain parameters. If you start picking up on those opportunities and feedback into the system, we will accelerate our learning. And so, yeah. So the nice thing about this is actually looking where you're looking. So in the first group, you started to see stuff. In the second group, why in the second condition? What made it easier for you?
To unravel yourself. What actually was the process, do you think, in the second group? Who were the other people in the group? Can everybody step forward into the group? Yeah, what actually happened in the second group? Where were you looking? Who were you taking instructions from? Within the group. So you're sitting there, sometimes you're not sure what to do, somebody just moves. And when they move, you're like, oh, you go with them. That's decision making. That's not synchronized decision making. That's what we call bottom-up emergent decision making. It's called shared intelligence. So any of you, put your hands up if you do team sports. Alright, you may have heard of what we call shared mental models. And then we've got shared affordances. It's completely different. A shared mental model means this is the way we play. So when you move, I have to move with you according to the plan. That's not this. You move because you can see an opportunity. I move with you to help you out, and he sees something with me, so we actually move collectively. In an individual sport, that should be the same for the coach and the athlete. Your shared collective movements and training should be shared knowledge. That knowledge is not on a piece of paper, it's embedded in the context. Context drives your behavior. So for that to happen, to be a skilled athlete, you need to look at the situation in context, share information, and answers emerge from those situations. That's an adaptive skill. And it's a funny feeling to have if you're an athlete and you're not used to being coached like that. You're like, waiting for the coach, not really saying anything. So try it and ask people how they feel. And it's like, yeah, it's really weird playing like this because you're playing on a field. If you talk to the All Blacks, they'll say, yes, we train for the ball to go here. And then we'll say, if it goes there, we'll normally go this way. So the plan is to go the same way. But occasionally they go this way. And you ask them, why did you go back this way when the plan normally is to go the same way? Because we felt the need to. The plan says we go this way, and if they go the same way, that's because they feel and the plan are the same. If they go back this way, they do it for a reason, because the plan's not going to work. So they've adapted it, and they feel they must go this way. That is a decision by an athlete, and that's decision-making training. So in fact, in some of our training sessions, we give our athletes wrong plans and give them wrong information, and you see how they adapt. We'll come back to you and go, I think we should change this. I think this needs to be changed as well. So anything on that? Did you want to say anything about that? No? Anything else? I just want to do something else. So let's say 12 people. So the inside people, can you just come in a little bit closer? Everybody on the inside, just come in closely. And I'll see how many people we've got. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Moving really, really close. Let's have 2 more people join in. Okay, everybody else, can I get you to stand right on the outside, please? Right on the outside. Okay, you guys, what I want you to do now is just spread out and position yourself in the space between you and everyone else. So fill the whole floor. Come into the middle. It doesn't matter where you are, just fill the whole space, okay? Make sure you've got space around you. Okay. Are you got all that space over there, guys, as well? Everyone else, move against the wall, please, if you're not involved in this. Okay, brilliant, really brilliant. Excellent. Okay. This is an adaptive system. This is an adaptive skill. This could be an elbow, that could be an ankle joint, that could be a knee joint, that could be one person in this space. But this could also be a team. This could be the midfielders. All right, suddenly we're playing. Now, the skill's happening in competition. I want to put as a coach just some constraints on you. What I would like you to do, don't tell anybody, but just pick two people in this group, somewhere around. It could be her, it could be him. Alright, so just have a look around the group, pick two people inside this group, not the people outside. So you guys found stability, then he moved, and then we all had to create new stability again. That's what a dynamic system is, that's what the coach does. As soon as somebody finds the answer, and they're comfortable, and they've got it, be a disturber. Disturb the practice. And then it has to find itself again, it has to find a new solution. That's an adaptive system that these guys just did. And it gets annoying. Some people in here are like, just stop. We've got stability, please stop it. God, there he goes again. Cracky, all right. That's why performance is. You can't control everything. So what you have to do is just be aware of all the information. So these people are looking at everybody. They started to see that he was a disruptor. If you move, two other people then move, and then we're coupled off you. So we have to move. There's no difference between a high performance system. You've got your directors, your high performance directors. They're connected, we're all interconnected. They move, we have to move. Alright, you've got to adapt to everything around you. Alright? Often we wish we didn't have people up there because they're the problem, to be honest. Hopefully there's no directors here, but when you direct, what's the problem? What did we do in the first exercise? We had a director on the outside. Yeah, we have to wait fucking hours. So grab your performance director and bring them into an exercise like this and just go.
We have actually discussed with everyone. We were talking about how we actually want to apply technical and tactical, and how I think most of us agree that everything should be done in a tactical approach first, and then comes the technical. Because when we do this, it is a way for them to actually grow in self-development. So how it goes is, I'm just going to give a small example about throwing. When we get someone to throw a ball, pick up a ball, okay, let's throw the ball forward. There are many kinds of throw. There are forward, there's a overhead throw, there's a underarm throw, there are many kinds of different throw. But the destination that they are trying to throw the ball to is going towards a certain direction or a specific direction. That becomes a development for the kids to actually do it implicitly. We do not tell them how it's done technically, but rather how they are gonna get the ball towards a specific direction. Yeah, so that's more of it. Yeah. Anyone else here? Okay, cool.
Yeah, just on that, probably more tips.
But also individual as well. These are just one of the conceptual frameworks that England Rugby follows now, and GB Hockey is exactly what you've said there as a group. You remember the old, what they call pillars or components of performance, technical, tactical, physical, mental, well, you just said tactical in the middle. It's exactly the same as what we've placed in England Rugby down. So in the middle, it's about the game. So as we talked about before, in terms of pedagogy and the non-linear pedagogy, we talk about this tactical obviously being quite a focus. And the technical we're calling actions. So these are the actions here, and they overlie the tactical. What fitness do we need to play like this? What behaviours do we need to play? What game preparation do we need to play like this? And that drives your technical actions anyway. But it's also got context, because context drives behaviour. So it's very, very contextual, this. And then you can add variability, and you can add your purposes, which emanate from the middle here. So this could be under 12, this could be under 16. So what are the developmental needs for a 12-year-old or a 16-year-old in the game, tactically, action-wise, preparation and fitness? And that will look slightly different to 20s, or 18s, or 20s, 21s. But you will have common principles to go through. So these common principles, for example, for an invasion sport, will be definitely football is to penetrate, rugby is to go forward. Do you see the similarity? You have to score over there, so you've got to go forward. The principles are intertwined with the rules of the game. So the reason yesterday I talked about rules and regulations, they are so important for coaches, because they interact with skill and they interact with the principles of the game. So the first rule is to score more points to win. To do that, we have to score over there. To do that, the first principle of play is to go forward. Okay? The second rule, the defense can stop you going forward. They're allowed to tackle you. Once the second rule is tackle, the second principle of play will be support, because I'm going to get tackled, so I have to use my support. So those two very simple rules are intertwined with the two first principles of an invasion sport. Now, decision making comes into this. How do I use my support? Well, if you're going to be a prescriptive coach and you're going to use structure and a 4-3-3, your kids are going to be very, very constrained to their supporting decision making skills. If you just let them play, they will have a self-organizing, emerging system that suits them. Some of the faster kids may go up the front. Some of the slower kids or the bigger kids may shoot up the back and start defending the goal. That is an emerging structure from the game, the backyard game. And as a coach, you need to observe this, look out for these things, and then work with that. You could prescribe it and say, let's play a 4-3-3. Sir, what does that mean? Oh, we've got four defenders, three midfielders, and three attackers. But then you let them self-organize that. So you say, here's a toy. It's like a child saying, here's a toy, here's a bike. What do? They jump on the bike, they play with the bike, and they realize what the bike opportunity affords them. Wow, this bike allows me to see different things. It allows me to go forward. It allows me to go quickly. What does the 4-3-3 do? It allows us to create opportunities to attack in different areas. It allows us to bring players into the game. It may not allow us to do other things. It may have some limits. They are your learning outcomes. So your learning outcomes are giving a toy, playing with a toy. What does it afford us? There's no difference between that and individual technique training. The technique is a toy for someone to play with. Does this shooting technique afford me more 10 points in the target? I'll play with this technique, it feels pretty good. And then you can give some internal focus instruction and some external, you can play with it transitioning. So really good point. That pathway there is something that the England football and the England rugby have brought on board as well more recently. So well done to your group there. Did you want to share? Yeah, sports psychology has now changed its name in the UK, the IS, to behaviour. What are the behaviours we're looking for in our athletes? To be honest, Vincent, I quite like it, because you know, athletes tend to think of sports psychologists as, I've done something wrong, I've got to go and see the psych, the guy with the white jacket. But psychologists would be saying, no, we're trying to demonstrate good sports psychology through behaviour. Athletes need to show and demonstrate those behaviours. That's a measure of how they've learnt. I quite like that. It's like an endpoint. So what behaviours do you want to be demonstrated? So we've got behaviours now in our pathway. So it's a bit of psychology, sports psychology. Game fitness, strength and conditioning, how you prepare tactically. Like if you're playing a high press game, the fitness required for that And some of the behaviors are different as well. Expect the unexpected. Expect to react and transition very quickly. So you can do that off the pitch, transition and organize yourselves quickly into a line or get on the bus quickly. All of these are transferring all over the place, they're not just on the pitch. Game preparation, rest, recovery, sleep, nutrition, they're all very important. So if you were to click on one of these, like I wanted to click on game preparation, I click on it, preparation moves to the middle, tactical move to the outside, and as I click preparation, there'll be more detail that emerges inside of that. Nutrition, what does nutrition look like for an under 16 year old? Based on the tactical way you're going. Of course, it may not differ too much, but you have some core principles. Carbohydrates, always carbohydrates. But you might need more of them than under 20s if you're going to play a certain type of game, for example. So this is age and skill relevant specific. That's some core principles. By the way, I'm not going to sell this. This is just a basic thing that we do. Look, I want to go to this group now who are going to share some of the stuff they did with badminton.
Based on the video just now, the coach was explaining how they try to implement this kind of implicit learning and how some students rejected it. So actually, this is actually what we implemented in our training, because for most of us coaches here, we are dealing with MOE. So with MOE, there are certain constraints. So one example, for my sport specifically, badminton, there's just me as a coach, and there's 50 boys, varying from 9 years old to 12 years old. So there's the beginners, the total blank white paper, then there's the intermediate, and then there's the advanced. So I could spend my time teaching the blank white papers to get up the pace with the rest of the team, but you could see that there is no structure. I mean, I could give a program to the bigger ones, but they're just fooling around the park, they're just playing. They won't even tell me. So we decided to, like, you know what? Let's flip it up. I took the older ones, I did a buddy system with every single new kid that came in. And what I did was, you know, we changed the whole idea of this. First they were asking, coach, why do we have to do this? We come here to train, we're not come here to teach, but you're the one who's supposed to teach. A boy actually told me this. So I actually told him this. Your school gave you the opportunity to train. A man doesn't only take, he also gives back. And this is your way of giving back to your community. Your school is your community. Without your school, you couldn't have learned this sport. So now it's time for you to give back to your school. Guide the new ones. They look up to you when you come to the school. You are the example they want to follow. So be the good example. So initially, for example, our trainings, we have like fundamentals that we do. Psychomotor skills, chassis movements, lunges, skipping, hop, and all that. So we got the seniors to teach them. Then the feedback came in. For example, one of my seniors was straight, not even 5 minutes into the program, because I mean, oh, I told the guy, doesn't want to listen. I tell him 5, 6 times, he's not doing it. Then I say, welcome to my life, because this is what I've been doing with you all this time. Now you know how I feel. And then he just smart at me and he went back. So over time, this thing actually blossomed, because as the time goes on, as these P3s that actually went up to become P5s, it became a self-auto-run system where whenever a culture actually established, meaning every time there were P3s, without even me asking, my P5s, which are the 11, and my P6, and the 12 years old, they will attend this part of the training and they look forward to doing this. So it was self-driven. Yeah.
Fantastic. Wait a minute, yeah. Well done. You just stole the show. I think that's brilliant. I mean, what you talked about there is a culture. Under the last clip there, it came up as, who watched the last clip that said Form of Life? Start looking at the research, and there'll be some research now talking about Form of Life. He's created a different form of life. Like, we're a species, we've developed in certain ways. We have tendencies. when you go into the, I went into the badminton hall just before with Vincent and watched the warming up, and I'm not saying it's bad, I'm just telling you how I saw it. Lots of rows, everyone doing the right ankle stretch together. If you went into somewhere like Barcelona or something like that, you'd have individual stretching going on, individual programs, and all be moving around in different ways, different shapes. It's a form of life that's being created. So if someone comes into there and they think, this is what I do. Why do I do what I do? It's the question I'd like to pose to you. Why do you do what you do in your environment? And have a think about that and challenge it as well. Okay, I know we've run out of time here, but that's a brilliant way to finish off on. I just want to thank you very much for your time this morning and showing up, and really appreciate it. Hopefully we got something out of this, and thanks very much.
Do you have any questions for Richard before you leave? Any question particular to your sport that you want to ask before we end it? Yes.
Just going back to creating problems for the players as a coach, and allowing them to find the solutions. I'm just wondering whether there are any strategies, or if you have any insights on strategies for, leading them to these solutions or assisting. You know, you could create a problem, they can see what the issue is. You may not be able to come to the solution. So, for example, a strategy could be at the beginning of training that you provide certain activities that may trigger the solution, or primers that may trigger the thing that, you know, that leads them in that direction. But if there are any other strategies, then.
Look, it's quite timely, and that's really good.
I definitely think that. In Singapore, I don't know what the population is here, but I know a former colleague of mine is watching down the back as well, Jai, but what I want to bring in is quite timely that there is already lots of good research about this, what we've been talking about the last couple of days, non-linear pedagogy and constraints. There are some very, very simple principles that underpin this. What I'd encourage you guys to do is the question you just asked. You guys should need to come together and share solutions to problems. First of all, there's a lot of athletes that can't even identify the problem in many sports. And we're already going on about designing solutions, when in fact athletes aren't given the opportunity to search practice space to find out actually what the problem is. We go in with predetermined solutions in our training sessions to problems that the athletes are not even aware of. And I'd say that's probably the fundamental problem we have in a lot of our coaching, is we don't have active learners in our sessions. We don't have students who come in going, I'm just waiting for the coach to trip me up. I can't wait to find and solve this problem and beat the game, or beat the coach, or beat my teammates. So I'd encourage you to do that. And everything I've tried to say over the last couple of days have been sort of my experiences based on those underlying principles. First of all, who solves the solution? Who identifies the problem? Well, it's the athlete, the learner. You need to design and learn to design in a world-class way of coaching group here in Singapore. You need to develop a community of coaches that can coach by underpinned principles where you design problems into your sessions. And if you need a periodization or a curriculum or a syllabus, and I talked about a syllabus today for individual athletes, the challenge for you is to collectively have a syllabus for what are the collective needs for a group or a team, and also individual syllabus within that. And he's just answered badminton, how to take care of individual needs by having a buddy system. Collectively, the coach's role will be, how do we create problems in sevens rugby for this year, for under 18s tactically in the middle, all right? Use a constraints approach, because what it does is it can help narrow the space for the solution to find it sooner, more relevant information, and they'll find that solution. Of course, the other option is you go in already with a solution. That's a different purpose to your session. The purpose today is we're working on a 4-3-3, or we're attacking the channel down the left-hand side. If that's, and I've said the problems with that already, what's the problems with going in with a predetermined solution sometimes into your session? So in attack, we're working on a particular sort of attack. What's going to be the issue? Who already knows the solution? The defense. So we're going to go down the left-hand side. The defense are waiting for us. So there's no interaction or decision-making going on. The attacker need the option to go wherever they like. They need to pick and choose the moment when they go down that left-hand channel and you reward that with some additional points. But to do that, they have to search the whole space and make the defense think they're going to go somewhere else. So you can go into a session with a predetermined solution, but be very, very aware that they're not, that's not necessarily going to transfer into the match. My experience of working with team-based coaches is we will make those mistakes. The England team did it in the last regime. We went into many matches having pre-planned our decision-making, and we rehearsed it in training. The opposition can see that we're going to do it, and we were so predictable, we got the ball taken off first and transitioned, and you can see points within minutes. There's no difference between that and the technique, and actually individually as well. So listen, I'm not saying you don't do that, just throw caution to the wind. The purpose is to find the solution, or is the purpose to adapt to the solution? If the purpose is to find a solution, well, you need to be bloody good at identifying the problem. So the coach needs to be very good at designing through constraints and setting out potential problems for the athletes. And you can prime them a little bit. You can say, look, we're going to have some problems. What did Danny Kerry do? What did Danny Kerry do? He's thinking Thursday, he designed the round one. What was the purpose around? To beat a defensive zone. Remember, the Dutch do it. Most of the hockey teams around the world will do that zone. So he's got thinking Thursday is all about attacking zone, and you'll get rewarded for it in different ways. But he never sets out on how you do that. So what actually happens is different skills emerge in the session. If we're going to beat them through the center, these sort of skills are needed: direct passing, heads up, communication, triangles, and that is the learning outcomes that occur. So I think my answer to that is quite simple, really. Our purpose is solution, or is it identify the problem coming up with the solution? I think traditionally coaches want to come up with a solution and they want to give it. Pull back from that tendency. Even in England Sevens, we had a very good coach recently, Barry Maddox. He's now retired, coaches in Wales. You speak to the girls in the England team. What do you think about Barry? Oh, Barry didn't know a lot. He didn't really coach us, didn't tell us much. He's one of the best coaches in the whole system. Then he challenged the girls and they felt uncomfortable because he wasn't telling them. And he doesn't mind me saying this, right? He knows that feedback, but that's the feedback you're looking for. That's positive feedback. That's how we measure his success. He's made the girls think. We could have put a coach in there who told them everything. So look, that's some of the things. I know that feels a little uncomfortable for some of you, but that's the way it is.
Join me again to thank Richard.